Okay, so let's first talk about the typical disturbance waveforms. And yeah, very often we are using radio frequency interference signals, in this case continuous wave signals, or amplitude modulated signals. Okay, this also comes from the ages of the radio telecommunication, because as I said in the past, it was very important to hear radio communication loud and clear without any interferences. And an interference during the old days was mainly a continuous wave signal or an amplitude modulated signal, for example, a crosstalk from another radio station. So at the system level, when we are characterizing whole systems like cars or laptops or whatever, very often we are using this unmodulated continuous wave signal, and then we are modulating by an amplitude modulation this noise signal with 80% modulation. And then the final disturbance signal looks like this. So it's modulated by a low frequency signal. And very often the low frequency signal is 1 kilohertz. At the IC level, it's exactly the same, but the only difference is that it's not modulated up. So it's the peak-to-peak excursion, the maximum peak-to-peak excursion is then exactly the same as the peak-to-peak excursion from the continuous wave signal. Don't ask me why they have defined it in this way. I don't know. Okay, but the interesting thing is, why do we use a 1 kilohertz amplitude modulation? Well, we could also use 10 kilohertz, 100 kilohertz. It's just a button at the signal generator. But there must be a special reason why they have chosen 1 kilohertz. Any idea? Yeah, hearing range, very good point. But the hearing range is from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz if you're young. So they could also have chosen 100 hertz.
Maybe the voice.
Yeah. Actually, the reason is that the human ear is all over this frequency range, the hearing frequency range, not always equal sensitive. Hope that was correct. So if you are generating a noise tone, and we are sweeping this noise tone with the same amplitude all over the hearing frequency range, we hear this noise signal at 1 kilohertz, the loudest. And this was then the reason why they have chosen 1 kilohertz amplitude modulation, because what usually happens in your IC, when you're forcing an amplitude modulated signal into your pins, input pins, for example, of the IC, you will end up somehow with a demodulation of this signal. And then inside of the IC, you will have a 1 kilohertz noise signal. And let's suppose your IC is a power amplifier, an audio amplifier, for example, then it's very likely that you are amplifying also this 1 kilohertz signal. And if you're hearing at 1 kilohertz the loudest, then it makes sense to characterize your system at 1 kilohertz. Okay, so this was the reason for this 1 kilohertz amplitude modulation. Yeah, and the basic idea behind all these measurement techniques is we would like to have a kind of susceptibility characteristic of our IC, which means that usually we are starting somewhere here at the start frequency and here at the stop frequency, we are stopping injecting our noise signal. And the basic procedure is always the same. We are starting here, for example, at 1 megahertz. We are increasing the amplitude of our disturbance signal until our IC is not working properly anymore. What does it mean? This is very complicated because there are different kinds of ICs, and there can be different kinds of interference or interferences. Let's think of a simple operational amplifier. we are amplifying with an amplification of 10. And it could happen that due to the injected noise signal, we'll later see how it's working, the amplification changes. It's not 10 anymore, it's 8. Now we have to define if 8 is still okay or 8 is already a malfunction. So depending on the monitoring criteria and how we are defining what's good and what's bad, we will get different susceptibility characteristics. So it's also very important that we are defining a good setup and a good monitoring. So let's suppose we are increasing the amplitude until our operational amplifier is not amplifying at 10 anymore, and this is then the point that we are marking here in this diagram. And we are moving the frequency step one forward to 2 megahertz, for example, increasing again until the operational amplifier is again not amplifying with 10 anymore. And so we get over the whole frequency range a characteristic, and we can see that our operational amplifier at 100 hertz is not very susceptible. And this is exactly the information that you would need when you are designing then an electronic system, because you know that at a certain frequency, my IC might have some troubles. And this is the information that you should ask from the IC manufacturers so that they can give you some further information on the susceptibility of your IC.